فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. Today is going to be our first lesson to the madkhal in aqidah, the introduction of aqidah. Today inshallah ta'ala we're going to take an overview of what aqidah deals with. Aqidah, brothers, is that which a person believes in their heart. لذلك, as you inshallah ta'ala will see in the class today, بإذنillah الكريم, the things that the aqidah deals with, the original essence of them is that which is in the heart. So inshallah ta'ala today, as I said, the first lesson is going to be an overview and a comprehensive observation of the chapters of aqidah. So inshallah ta'ala, students, pay attention with me inshallah ta'ala. Here on the board, bi'idhnillah al-kareem, as inshallah ta'ala from today onwards I will be using the board for every class, is written all in Arabic. And inshallah ta'ala I will translate and explain every point and every word that is written on the board inshallah ta'ala. Here I have Mujmal Abwab al-Aqidah. So at the top heading I have Mujmal Abwab al-Aqidah. What does that mean? The word Mujmal is comprehensive. But in this context it means an overview of the chapters of Aqidah. If a person today wants to open an Aqidah book and they want to study Aqidah, what is it that Aqidah deals with? By reading an Aqidah book, what does it mean that I learn? Because many people don't understand. Aqidah books, they deal with these points that inshallah ta'ala you will learn in this lesson, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Aqidah, it deals with two things. Or the chapters of Aqidah are two chapters. The first one is Arkanul Iman, the pillars of Iman, which inshallah ta'ala you're going to see, which are these six pillars. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And the second thing is مَا يُلْحَقُ بِأَرْكَانِ الْإِيمَانِ, the things that are attached. So مَا يُلْحَقُ, يُلْحَقُ means what? Attached to the pillars of Iman. The things that are attached to the pillars of Al-Iman, which are three inshallah ta'ala, and I'm going to quickly go over them. And so in this introduction, we're going to be taking these six, and we're going to be taking these three. And that is the introduction course, the 16 hours of the Madkhal of Aqidah is going to revolve around those six, plus those three, and that should make nine inshallah ta'ala. Those nine headings, or those nine chapters, is what we're going to be taking inshallah ta'ala for our introduction to Al-Madrasat Al-Umariyah. Let's start with the first of the six pillars. Arkanul Iman, as you all are aware of, is from the famous hadith in Sahih Muslim, min hadith Umar ibn al-Khattab. The famous hadith known as the hadith of Jibreel, that is narrated by the companion Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And it's collected in Sahih Muslim. The hadith is also in Bukhari, but it's not narrated from Umar, it's narrated from who? It is narrated from Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That famous hadith that we know, when Jibreel came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the Prophet, أخبرني عن الإيمان, tell me about Iman. What is Iman? And the Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam, he responded and he said to Jibreel, الإيمان أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره. And the Prophet told him these six that inshallah ta'ala that we're going to bi-idhnillah al-kareem touch on. The first one is, of the six pillars of Iman, is to believe in Allah. It's to believe in who? It is to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believing in Allah means you believe three things. Or, in another wording, it is when three things are settled with you, then we will say al-imanu billahi of yours is intact. It's according to how it should be. It's in accordance with the methodology of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The first one is rububiyyah. The rububiyyah. And inshallah ta'ala we're going to take what rububiyyah means in more details. This is an overview. We don't need to explain it in this lesson. We just need to know what's written on the board. The second one is al-uluhiyyah. Al-uluhiyyah. And the third one is asma' was-sifat. So believing in Allah means you single Allah in His rububiyyah, His uluhiyyah, and His al-asma'i was-sifat. That individual who singles Allah in the rububiyyah and uluhiyyah and al-asma'i was-sifat is a believer. Believer of who? Believer of Allah. And he has fulfilled that condition of al-imanu billah. The second one is al-imanu bil malaika, believing in the angels. Now, inshallah ta'ala, the explanation and the information pertaining to that will also, inshallah ta'ala, be in our upcoming lessons, inshallah ta'ala. The third one is al-imanu bil kutub, believing in the books that were sent by and sent down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believing in the books that were sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth is al-imanu bil-rusul, believing in the messengers that were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You believe in each and every one of them, and that you don't reject one. And rejecting one means you've rejected all of them. And inshallah ta'ala, we will touch on that more further, inshallah ta'ala, in our upcoming lessons, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. The fifth one is al-imanu bil-yawm al-akhir. It is to believe in the day of judgment. What does it mean, believe in the day of judgment? How can one believe in the day of judgment? What explanations and what evidences are there for this? We'll speak about that in more details, inshallah, in our upcoming classes, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. The sixth one, inshallah ta'ala, is going to be al-imanu bil-qadr. Believing in the predestiny. That which Allah has destined for you subhanahu wa ta'ala and that He has written for you. What is it? And does one have to believe in it? And what does it mean believing in the qadr? Those are the six pillars that I'm hoping inshallah ta'ala that every single one of you has probably studied, does know, but inshallah ta'ala we will still solidify ourselves with better understanding and more evidences, inshallah ta'ala. And as you're all aware of, my brothers and sisters who are watching, that some matters you may think to yourself, I've probably studied it before and I know it. But the fact that it's repeated again and that it's taught to you again, it will solidify what you already knew. And it's also upon the teachers and those who educate the people to start with them with the basic knowledge. As Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he said about the Alim al-Rabbani is الَّذِي يُرَبِّ النَّاسَ بِالصِّغَارِ الْعِلْمِ قَبْلَ كِبَارِ, is the one who nurtures the people on the small knowledge before he puts them and indulges them into the great knowledge or the big knowledge. He starts off with the basic stuff. And these are the most simplistic and so the most easiest things that a believer studies, and it's one of the most vital things that a person needs to know. Here on this side, we have what we named ما يلحق بأركان الإيمان. ما يلحق بأركان الإيمان is that which we will also follow up with the Iman. The Iman and its six pillars. Or the six pillars of Iman, these three are followed up with it. In other words, they are also dealt with in the books of Aqidah. And those three are what? Musamma al-Iman. Here, I have here Musamma and al-Iman. Musamma means what? It means the term Iman. The term Iman. So the books of Aqidah you study, what does Iman mean? What's the correct definition for it? What are the things that nullify your Iman? What are the things that weaken your Iman? What are the groups who've opposed Ahlul Sunnah in the matters pertaining to the Iman? So in books of Aqaid and books of Aqidah, you will see they talk about this issue of Iman. So you see they talk about the Khawarij, and then they speak about the Murji'ah, and then they speak about the Mu'tazila, and then they mention Ahlul Sunnah where they stand regarding this concept of Al-Iman. Because the word Iman, my brothers and sisters, the prosperity of this world and the hereafter is connected to it. What do I mean by that? A person, whether he can be buried with the Muslims, whether janazah can be prayed on him, whether his wife can still be married to him, whether his blood is sacred, all of that is connected to his Iman. So his Iman, whether he has it or not, is very vital in this world. And of course in the hereafter. Why? Because if this person does not have the Iman that he should have, he will definitely enter in the hellfire forever, and he will never come out of it. And he will stay there forever. He will get Allah's wrath, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the list goes on. All of that is to say that it is important that the reality of Iman is understood. Because if a deficiency occurs in the perception of Iman, the comprehension of Iman, it means that a person who does not deserve this noble title will not get it. I mean, will not get his title. And a person who is not befitted to be a believer will be given the title. The second one, inshallah ta'ala, is the issue pertaining to the companions, as-sahaba. As you see here, it says, as-sahaba. As-sahaba are the companions. Again, there are groups who've deviated from Ahlul Sunnah and they went against their path in the issue pertaining to the companions. What did they do? We find, for example, the Shia who came, the issue pertaining to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And so, they took him out of the realm of being a human being. And they gave him divinity. And they said he's divine. And they worship him. And they made him infallible. And then you find the Khawarij, they came and they took Ali ibn Abi Talib out of Islam. And they took him out of the fold of this religion. So you have two extremes. And you see Ahlul Sunnah who have taken the middle path. And that is what we're going to be speaking about, the issue pertaining to As-Sahaba. Last but not least, we will be speaking about the issue of Al-Imamah. The issue of Al-Imamah. When we say the issue of Al-Imamah, we're going to speak about many things. We will speak about, inshallah ta'ala, the issue of the rights that the Muslim leader has and the responsibilities that are upon those who he governs. And can the people rebel against the leader? We'll also be speaking about who can hold the khilafah for the Muslims and issues pertaining to that. You tend to find all of these 9 points in the books of Aqaid. And these are the Mujmal. These are the Mujmal Abwabul Aqidah. They are the overview chapters of Aqidah. So when you open an Aqidah book, whether the Aqidah book is Aqidah al-Tahawiyah, whether the Aqidah book is Aqidah al-Salafi wa Ashab al-Hadith by Al-Imam al-Sabuni, or I'tiqadu Ahlul Sunnah and Ahlul Hadith by Abu Bakr al-Ismaili, or whether Aqidah book is the book Aqidah al-Wasitiyah, or whether the Aqidah book is the Aqidah of Abu Hatim al-Razi and Abu Zur'at al-Razi, the Aqidah book, whether it's the Aqidah of Abdul Ghani Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi, and the list goes on. Whenever you open those Aqaid books, those books of Aqidah, you will find that they speak about these 9 topics, And from these nine topics, many different subheadings come from it. And so inshallah ta'ala, now that we've taken in this class, what are the chapters that are dealt with in Aqeedah? Inshallah ta'ala, in our next lesson, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, we will speak about the first one of them, which is al-imanu billah. But before I let you all go, I have to go over with you something that is as important as the class that we have taken today, inshallah ta'ala. We'll inshallah conclude with this point, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. And that is, مَزْدَرُ التَّلَقِّي عِنْدَ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ. What does it mean? مَزْدَرُ التَّلَقِّي عِنْدَ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ is, مَزْدَر means source. التَّلَقِّي is to take from. According to Ahli Sunnah and Jama'ah. So in simple terms, it means, where do Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah take their evidences from? Where do they take their religion from? And since we're talking about Aqeedah, where is it that one should go and take their belief from? According to Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they take their aqeedah from three sources. One, two, and three. The first one is Al-Kitab. And the Kitab is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Jibreel came down with onto our messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This book that we have, this 30 chapter, or 30 ajza, 30 juz, and 114 surah. There are 114 surahs in the Quran, and there are 30 juz, 30 ajza. That book, Al-Kitab, the divine speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the last testament that ever came down. As-Sunnah means what? As-Sunnah means ما أضيف إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من قول أو فعل أو تقرير أو صفة خلقية أو صفة خلقية أو خلقية. It means anything that is attributed to the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. Speech, action, consent. The way he looked and his character. How many things did I say? Speech, one. Actions, two. Consent meaning anything that was done in his presence and he acknowledged, he agreed. Four. His appearance and how he looked. Last but not least, his etiquette and his manners and the way he carried himself, alayhi salatu wasalam. Those five are called sunnah. Now, as you can all see, I categorize the sunnah into two. Because this is a place where the deviated sects try to say that we only take one type of the sunnah and then we don't take the other type. Ahl Sunnah, they take the Mutawatir and the Ahad, both of them. What is Mutawatir? And what is Ahad? Mutawatir means the narrations that come to us from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a multitude narration. Multitude. It is large in quantity. It's called Mutawatir. Ahad means few. Don't say singular, but say few. Because within Ahad there is Mashhur and Aziz and Ghareeb. It is the narration that comes to us, لم يبلغ حد التواتر, but that has not reached the amount of a mutawatir. It hasn't reached that number. It's few in number. Ahlul Sunnah don't care. They take Ahad. Whether that narration reached us in a multitude narration or whether it reached us in few narrations, it doesn't matter to Ahlul Sunnah. They are all acceptable. And there are many evidences for that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal by himself to Yemen to convey Tawheed, to convey Aqeedah. Are you with me? He sent Dihyatul Kilbi, رحمه الله رضي الله تعالى عنه, another companion. The Prophet sent him, صلى الله عليه وسلم, to the leaders. And the list goes on. So, rejecting a singular narration, as Ibn Hazm said, رحمه الله, in his kitab, الأحكام, أما الإحكام في أصول الأحكام, الإحكام في أصول الأحكام. He mentions, رحمه الله, Ibn Hazm, he mentions that if singular narration is rejected and it's not taken, and we see that the Prophet sent Mu'adh and Dihya, radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, may Allah be pleased with both of them. If singular narration was not accepted and it was rejected, then Ibn Hazm said it would have been a waste of time that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent them and their statements weren't going to be taken. It's basically insulting the Prophet's intelligence and his thinking to just waste two noble companions' time and effort and send them to different lands to convey Islam, but in reality, their statement are not going to be taken because they're only one individual or two or so who are conveying this information. Does that make sense? But in reality, those who reject the had narrations are indirectly trying to reject the Sunnah. And that's what they're really trying to get to. So no one should accept that from them. Al-Ijma' is also from the sources where Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they take their religion from. Is Al-Ijma' consensus. Ijma' is ittifaq mujtahidi hadhihi al-ummah. It is the agreement of a people who have reached a high caliber of comprehension and understanding in the religion. But they have to be from this religion, from this ummah. They can't be from the Jews or the Christians. They have to be Muslims. And the ijtihad from those scholars has to occur after the Prophet, that consent has to occur after the Prophet died. Because if it happens at the time of the Prophet, it takes consent. It's a taqrir. So ijma' is after the Prophet's death, alayhi salatu wa salam. And there are types and that it's categorized into. But for what we need to understand in this muqaddimah, in this introduction of aqidah, if one asks you, where do you take your religion from? You need to say, I take it from the kitab, I take it from the sunnah, I take it from the ijma'. I take the sunnah, whether it's a multitude narration, whether it's a few in narration, it does not matter to me. That's where I take my religion from. In other words, this is a refutation on those who take their religion and their aqidah from what? Intellect and logic. Does intellect say anywhere here? The aqidah is a ikhbar. It is information and it's news. And you can't reach that conclusion with the smartness of your mind and the way that your mind works, and it doesn't come from that. It has to come from these three sources. And that is where you need to take your religion from. Last but not least, aqa'idah, which is munjiyatu min al-dalal. Aqa'idah, which saves you. Qa'idah, munjiyah, that saves you min al-dalal, from misguidance. This qa'idah you need to memorize. It saves you from misguidance. And that is what? How do I understand the kitab? How do I understand the sunnah? And how do I understand the ijma'? We said that the sunnah and the ijma', those are the three sources we take our religion from. The question is how do we understand it? When can we say there's a consensus in this issue? Who can say that? How do we extract a ruling from the kitab? How do we extract a ruling from the sunnah? This qa'idah is what answers that question. And this qa'idah is a munjiyah. Munjiyah means what? It saves you min al-dalali, it saves you from misguidance. It saves you from misguidance, which is fahmul kitabi, to understand the kitab, was sunnah, and to understand the sunnah, يجب أن يكون على وفق فهم سلف الصالح. The kitab and the sunnah Both of them have to be understood. Yajibu, it is obligate. So fahmu, understanding. Al-kitabu, the book, the Quran. Was-sunnah, and the prophetic tradition. Yajibu, it is obligatory. An yakuna, for it to be. Ala wifqi, in accordance to what? Fahmi salafi salih, the understanding of the pious predecessors. So a person cannot just come to the Quran and the Sunnah and understand it the way they will and the way they wish. The Quran and the Sunnah have to be understood in how the pious predecessors understood it. So once we've affirmed that we take the Kitab and the Sunnah, whether it's a multitude narration, whether it's a few narrations, and the consent, once we've agreed that's where we take our religion from, we also have to agree that the understanding in which we take to understand the Quran, to understand the Sunnah, and also to even affirm ijma' has to be based upon what? Upon how the Salafus Salih, the pious predecessors who've preceded us in good. And that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in Surah At-Tawbah, Ayah 100. Surah At-Tawbah, Ayah 100. Allah says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ, the first generations, the early comers, from them is the muhajirin, and they are the ones who migrated from Mecca, and they migrated to Medina. The second one are who? The Ansar, those who stayed and resided in Medina. And they gave victory to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam when he migrated to Medina. They gave him victory alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah says those two groups. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ, and those who follow them, بِإِحْسَانٍ, in good. So those who follow them, and that's us. We are not from the Muhajirin, and we are not from the Ansar. But if we want to be from those who Allah says, look after that, what did He say? وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ, Allah is pleased. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْ, Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. Who is Allah pleased with? And who is pleased with Allah? And who is Allah pleased with? Allah is pleased with the Muhajirin. Allah is pleased with the Ansar. And Allah is pleased with those who follow them. So, in order to gain this reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being pleased with us, and for us being true believers who are pleased with their Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to come with these characteristics of understanding our religion, understanding the Quran, understanding the Sunnah, in how the Salafus Salih, the pious predecessors, understood it. That is our first lesson inshallah ta'ala today. And inshallah ta'ala we will take our second lesson next week. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. أستغفرك وأتوب إليه.